Sure, my stuff is actually working. Ellie, if you want to do a announcement post, thank you. Assuming all this, there you are.
Starting to get to the point where I'm gonna need my own DM screen just to keep track of everything.
We actually just got a DM screen, so I'm super happy about that for an in-person one. Yeah, we also have like a oh my God, what is it called? Ellie. The dry erase markers for dry erase boards and
Tiles.
stuff. Tiles. That is dry erase tiles.
Oh,
So, yeah,
there you go.
super excited about it. She's gonna have a lot of fun with it. But all right, here we go. Do to do. Everything sounds good. Hello and welcome, dear patrons, to the Tables of Tartarus, a chapter of Purgatory Corner. Today with us, we have our storyteller and DM, Benny, as well as our companions, myself, Gromish, Mara, who's playing Athol, Rhaegar, and Ellie, who's Jane. Come on in, take a seat, and let your imagination run free in Adventures into the End Times. Benny, if you want to start us off.
Thank you, and thank you for having me on. So, yes, Adventures into the End Times. If you'll allow me to wax philosophical for just a moment, what this story is meant to be is a story about stories. It's based on a historical period called the Late Bronze Age collapse, and you can go on and on about the history we know, which talks about great kingdoms and empires. This is meant to be a story about not that. It's meant to be a story about the farmers, the merchants, and in your case, the people who would be wandering and adventuring. Of course, we can't ever recreate real history of the world, but it's fun to imagine it and maybe add a little bit of magic. So, with all of that in mind, where we had left off, we have caught up with Athol and Ellie's long-lost relatives, and we have discovered that the forest where they are both from was attacked and is still haunted by an entity that the survivors don't have the means to defeat, but they're hoping that Athol and Ellie, being magical, and Gromish and Rhaegar having magic weapons, you all might be able to do something about. Since you had already essentially gone around and done an introduction of the characters, I think I'm going to just go ahead and jump right into the story, unless anyone objects.
Sounds good to me.
Okay, so you all have been traveling with Athol and Jane's relatives. They've informed you a little bit of the situation. You are approaching this haunted and abandoned forest. Is there anything any of the characters in particular would be doing in preparation for this encounter?
Gromish would probably look at Athol and he'd be like, you magic you a big me big magic you have?" It's clearly not a request he often asks.
Yeah, Athol just stares the guy. I'm not sure what you mean. Are you talking like making you another size bigger? Because I thought you could already do that. Okay, I can do that. Yes.
Okay. You make me big. I get bigger and then I crush like a can.
Fair enough. Yeah. And Athol is also going to be collecting supplies for their healing kit because they have a feeling they're going to burn all their spell slots.
Okay.
All right, so with the help of the gnomes and goblins who are very familiar with this area, let's go ahead and do a nature check with advantage. You can't really fail this. It's just going to be a question of how well it goes.
Okay. That is an unnatural 23 as opposed to a
All right.
natural.
So you're able to gather quite a few components, and since it takes a couple of days for you to get there, I'm going to say on this journey, you're able to add three basic healing potions to your inventory,
Very
which you
nice.
can, if you want to hold on to them or if you want to disperse them among the party, I'm going to leave that entirely up to you all's discretion.
I'm going to give one to each barbarian and then keep the other two for myself just in case, depending on who gets hurt.
Okay.
All right. Rangers on her own. Got it.
So that heals us for 50 points, right?
You know what?
Take it up with the goblin. I'm not the one who made the decision. All right, so that covers what Gromish and Athel are primarily doing. What are Renegar and Jane going to be doing as they're on this trip?
So Athel and Jane told us about this creature that keeps like jumping from shadow to shadow, right?
Mm-hmm.
Their relatives did.
Okay, so during the journey, at some point, I'll have looked to both Athel and Jane at one point. Light. Big light. No shadows. Or.
I mean, I have the light spell, but I don't think that's enough to kill a shadow beast, just a guess.
Do we have Big Boom?
I don't believe so. But It could be also figuratively shadow. It could be like it only lurks in the shadows, or it's looks like a shadow.
We should get Big Boom. How do we get Big Boom?
Oh, we could always set the forest on fire again.
Okay, well, based on what happened before and what we've heard so far, catching things on fire is not a good idea. I don't think anyone else wants a resource supply shortage, like my loving home. And she sends daggers to Renegar.
I'm just kind of picking my ear. I don't even, like...
Uh-huh.
Some of the people around you are inconspicuously eavesdropping on this conversation, and when you get to the part about starting forest fires, it becomes a little less inconspicuous. They're not necessarily openly challenging you. There's just kind of this, wait, what?
So, no Big Boom, no big fire. We could hit the sun.
Hit the sun?
Yes. We get big enough, we big grab buddy. The sun, and we hit people with it.
I don't think you can beat the sun.
But it's right there. It's just pointing upwards to the trees.
Buddy, does the sun cause you pain?
Probably. He's just gonna stick his hand up and be like, no, sun, okay.
Okay, but if you look at it for too long, it'll hurt your eyes.
Oh. We need to make him look at the sun.
I don't know if that'd work too well, buddy, especially since he's in a forest. He might also just hide in the shadows where the sun can't touch him.
So, throw him above the trees. Gotcha.
So at this point, you're going to hear some throat clearing, and Jane's grandfather is going to have been standing there sort of waiting for a moment to politely join the conversation without interrupting anybody. And he's going to say, if it helps, what we've been able to observe is that this creature or creatures, we're not sure, they seem to shroud this area of the forest in a sort of magical darkness. It's not full dark, but it's perpetual twilight, even though there are no leaves on any of the trees.
Oh. We can't throw him into the sun. Oh. Oh, well. Can we bring the sun to him? I just don't, like, look at Athel. You magic. Can we throw sun at dark guy?
Well, you know, my teacher did start to educate me on how to cast the sunlight spell. Oh. But unfortunately, the local baker was making some bread, and that's actually when I ran off. So I haven't actually finished learning that spell yet.
Oh. Bread important.
Good bread.
Good bread. So we just slash. All right. I can slash. I will throw, he like points at Rhaegar. I will throw Fur Buddy, and he'll fly and chomp. There we go. Good plan.
As long as I'm not on your shoulder at that time, we're good.
Ah, yeah, you stay on tree branch. He's just on, like, kind of pat a tree branch, like, yeah. And, a bow, and, I grow big, and, magic man makes me grow big, and, then I throw Fur Buddy, and we beat it. Yeah. Good plan.
You know, big buddy, I like this side of you. I'm glad you're making the plans. Of course, it should never go wrong.
I make good plan, yeah. I make good plan.
And Jade's just gonna pat his head.
I should make more plan, yeah. How do we get to sun?
It's just one natural 20 away.
Love it.
So the people around you have gone from being concerned about your conversation to somewhat baffled by it, and it's not, nobody explicitly says they assume the forest fire was sort of random babbling, but the talking about grabbing the sun makes them less suspicious that you're the cause of the recent problems here.
Right. We're on another intellectual level from these people.
My 7 intelligence is so far
above. Yeah, that's the thing. We're not sure if that intellectual level is above or below theirs. We're just on another one.
Fair. Alright, so as you continue on your journey, something you're going to... A couple of things you're going to notice. One of them is that despite the weather not changing, the forest does get noticeably darker. The other thing I think you're going to notice it most strongly with Jane's grandfather is that he's going to start breathing a little more heavily and needing more frequent rests. But this is going to be true not just of him, it's going to be true of all of the folk that you're traveling with. And it's going to reach a point where you get to a point where ahead of you, the forest just becomes noticeably dark, and there's no cloud cover or anything that would be causing this. And when you reach that point, Jane's grandfather is going to actually stop and sit down on a log, and he's visibly breathing somewhat labored.
Yeah, Jane's like flying off of Gromish's shoulder and going to him. It's like, no, not losing another person. Let's not. Are you okay, Grandpa?
I will be. I'm afraid this is as far as I can go with you. A lot of our magic is drawn from the earth itself and from the forest, and we've gotten too close. So I can't go any further on with you. And he's going to go on to say, the hope is that when you defeat this creature and its hold over the land is beaten, that's when everything will be restored and we'll be free to travel and we'll have our power back. And he's going to take kind of a deep, steadying breath, and he'll continue on saying, my power is a fraction of what it was before everything went wrong, but I can still do this for my granddaughter. And he's just going to lightly touch your forehead, and you're going to get +1 to AC in any saving throws you make for the next 24 hours.
Aww.
And at that point, the rest of the folk who've been traveling with you, the leader of them, actually it's Athel's brother, is going to say, we're going to post up back here. If you need to retreat, do it. And this person's going to look at Athel for a long moment. Like, this is not a warm or particularly affectionate person, so they're clearly struggling to say what it is they want to say. But finally, he's going to say, I've gone a long time without family, and I'm not trying to lose what family I have now. So if you need to run, do it. We'll be back here, and we'll be making healing potions from those herbs you collected.
Athel nods at this, like, oh, don't worry. We'll be the first to run out of there if things go bad.
Grommish just don't look at them and just go, we will win and we'll be back.
Just take care of yourself, Grandpa, okay? Don't want to lose anyone else in this journey.
All right, so some of the other gnomes kind of put their arms under his and sort of guide him back the way you came, so he's further from this dark magical effect. And essentially, you were left not too far from the people who guided you, but you are still left on your own, almost at the threshold of this dark forest. So what do you want to do?
Before we head out, I'm going to try and get as much information. I'm going to try and get more information about this creature so I can maybe track it better.
All right.
Basically what I'm trying to figure out is if they think it's like more of a monster or an undead, an aberration, celestial fiend type of deal. Like I'm trying to get as much information as I can to sort of piece everything together in my head.
All right. So what they're able to tell you is that this thing seems to feed off of the life force of other creatures that it destroys. Like it gets stronger as it attacks other things. It's things that are not magical don't seem to have much effect on it. And there's something they're not quite able to determine what it is. The magic is not of this world. And they have a really hard time assessing exactly what type of magic it is. Part of that's because of their limited magical ability, but part of it is also because of just there's something really strange about it that they don't understand.
Okay, so, all right. So based on what that sounds like to me, I think this will apply. So when I'm tracking it, I have something called Eldritch Hunter, where I can add my proficiency bonus to an ability check to track or ID it.
Okay.
So, while we're going through trying to track it down, I think at this point is when I'll try and take point and sort of try to track it down a little better.
All right. What's the marching order for the rest of the party if Renegar is taking point?
I would probably actually be in the back if Renegar is in the front.
Okay.
Athel is going to position themselves in the sort of to the side, but in the middle of the group, so that if anything attacks from behind or forward, I'll be able to cast magic and I'll be able to guard the flank a little bit.
Jane is going to be on Gromish's shoulder as always, watching this surrounding of the group.
All right. So as you make your way into the darkened section of the forest, it's not physically cold, but there's definitely a chill to it. And there's a feeling of there being nothing alive here. So even in the drought-stricken parts of the forest, there were things like mushrooms, there were things like insects. There was stuff that was making its living among the sort of ruined forest. And here you're not getting any of that. It's just cold and gloomy and unnaturally dark. There's no canopy overhead, but it's still much darker than it should be for the time of day it is. And Renegar, if you would like to go ahead and make your I suppose that would be a nature check to track the thing.
Okay. That is a 21.
All right. So on a 21, what is striking to you about your immediate search of the area is you don't find tracks of anything at all. Nothing has been coming through here, which again is really weird because normally there would be something moving through a forest, even if it's not what you're looking for. And as you all are making your way in, it's pretty easy to move around here because there's no undergrowth or anything like that. There's nothing blocking your path. There's dead or dying trees spread out around the place at fairly regular intervals, but the lack of anything at all growing means that there's also nothing obstructing your movement. What you do notice is everything is cast in shadow, but some of the shadows are much deeper than others, to the point that even with your dark vision, it's very hard to see into them. And Athel and Jane, I think both of your passive perception is 14. So off to your left, you're going to notice a pair of yellow eyes peering out at you from one of the shadows.
Can I try to get a better look at it? I don't want to assume it's hostile.
All right, go ahead and make a perception check.
Could Jane do that too?
Yes.
Her passive is 16, but I want to check.
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
I got a natural one.
All right. So you recognize...
Jane got 18.
Okay. Athel, you recognize that this is someone's escaped house cat, and you have a strong desire to go and pick it up and get it safely home. Jane, you are looking into a face that is vaguely humanoid, but not in any way. It's not just not human, but it's nothing remotely humanoid. It's oversized. It's as big as Gromish is when you see him get big. And it's in a somewhat of a crouched position. And it seems to be, it's like it blends with the shadow around it. Like the creature itself almost is shadow, and it's just taking a more solid form. Are you, when you look at it, are you trying to make it a point to be inconspicuous about it, or are you looking right at it?
To be more inconspicuous, because right, as soon as I notice Athel's also looking in that general direction, I'd probably like kind of not directly glance over, but just I'm aware that it's something there.
All right.
And it's definitely not a house cat. So I'm curious what Athel's going to do. Depending on what they do, I might respond.
All right. So Athel, looking at what is clearly an adorable house cat in this dark forest, what are you going to do?
I am going to cast a light spell over it to try and get a better look.
All right. So you cast the light spell, and at this point, the whole party is seeing this oversized creature of shadow now cast in the light. And it has a mangy, sorry, I can't quite think of the word, but the skin is tight across bone. It's got a vaguely humanoid shape, although all of the proportions are weirdly elongated. Like the skin is stretched over the bone. And when you cast the light spell, it is immediately going to disappear. And then it's going to reappear in a shadow behind you. And does 14 hit your AC?
It meets it, so I believe it beats it, yeah.
Is this something I can react to?
No, because it just appears and attacks. There's no, it's essentially a teleportation. It doesn't walk or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So it makes its attack. And That's going to be 13 necrotic damage.
Ow.
And I need you to please make a dexterity saving throw.
That is a 3, and I'm going to begin using a different dice.
Okay.
That's a good play.
So Athel is knocked prone, and I think now is an excellent moment for the party to roll initiative.
Well, this is fun.
That'll be a 13 from Gromish.
That's a 6 from Athel.
Dice are having a hard day.
17 for Jane. What was the other abilities that I got from Grandpa?
Plus 1 to AC and damage and saving throws.
Okay.
All right. So, Renegar, you are up.
This thing is still. This thing is still like in corporeal, I guess.
It's standing over Athel, and as you're looking at it, it's strange because you can see it, but it feels like you're also partially looking through it. Hmm. And its form is there, but it's like the edges are blurring into what's around it.
Okay. So I'm going to rage, and you said this thing's one size larger, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm going to charge at it, and I'm going to try to grapple it. I want to try and bring it to ground.
All right, so you're raging, which I believe gives you advantage on strength-based checks. So here's the thing. As you attempt to grapple with this thing, what you discover is that its form isn't entirely corporeal, so it's like trying to grab something that's really slippery or just not quite all there. So you would have disadvantage to grapple it, so your advantage and disadvantage cancel each other out, so just roll normally.
Okay. And this is what, an athletics check, right?
Mm-hmm. I believe so, yes.
That is a 15.
15 does not work. It slips out of your grip.
I had a feeling it wouldn't.
In the brief moment you're tangled up with it, one of the things you're going to recognize is this thing is strong. Like, probably stronger than you.
All right, but I've at least gotten it off of Athel, right?
Yeah, I mean, you're kind of there protecting your buddy.
Okay. Yeah, that's all my turn.
All right, so that's going to bring us to Jane.
So Jane is going to... Oh, okay. Can I Hunter's Mark it?
Yes.
Okay, I'm going to Hunter's Mark it and take a shot on it then.
Okay, am I correct in remembering that you're using a bow that's a plus 1 magical bow?
It's a regular bow.
Oh, it's a regular bow? Okay.
Yeah, it's just a regular long bow.
Okay, so go ahead and make your attack roll.
That will be a...
It's the first number, so 11.
Okay, I was like, wait, I wasn't too sure. I can't remember. That would be 11.
All right, 11 does not hit.
Well, I doubt a 12 would hit because of additional attacking from Gramps, but yeah.
Okay. So, yep, arrow. Looks like it's going to hit it, but just kind of sails through the edge of it without stopping or making contact. And that will bring us to Grommish.
Okay. So Grommish, looking at this, especially seeing the arrow fly through, but mostly the damaging to Athol, he's going to rage, which would be his bonus action. And during his rage, he's going to use his Path of the Giant ability. I can infuse my weapon of choice that I'm holding with one of the following damage types: acid, cold, fire, thunder, or lightning. I will do lightning for this one. See what it does. And it basically just does an extra 1d6 damage when it hits. So he's raging, grows double his size, adds that, and then he's going to reckless attack. So it will get advantage against me, but I get advantage on melee attack rolls using strength during this turn. So I'm going to do that plus my feat, Great Weapon Master. I'm going to take a -5 penalty to my attack roll, but if I hit, I add +10 to my damage.
Bold strategy, Cotton. Let's see how it works out for him. Go ahead.
We will see if I get horribly injured. So the first one will be an 8 high. I'm assuming that's going to miss horribly.
You're assuming correct.
All right, and then his second attack is a natural 20.
Natural 20 definitely hits.
All right. So the actual hit itself was 28 because of my +10, along with 3 and 4 for my 2d6s. So that's 35 damage. Do you do double or just double dice? I don't remember.
Double the dice. Roll the dice twice. Okay.
So double the dice, cool. Hold on just one moment. 1d12 plus d6 plus 1d6. Oops. /r. So that'd be 35 plus 17 plus 52 plus. Do I have any other plus? I don't think I do. No, it's each creature within. Oh, and when I get a critical hit because Great Weapon Master, I can make one more. Oh no, that's a bonus action. Never mind, I don't get that. So 52 damage in total.
Okay. Alright.
And that'll be my turn.
That's a solid hit. What weapon were you attacking with?
My Stirring Dragon's Wrath Grey Axe, which is magical.
All right. So I need you to make a strength saving throw.
Will do.
No.
That'd be 23.
Alright, so what happens is your weapon hits, it clearly hits. You see it cleave into this creature, and despite shadow substance, it does damage. Tendrils of shadow wrap around the weapon, and you feel it trying to tug it out of your hand as you're in this situation, but because of your high roll, you're able to yank it back free.
And because of the natural 20, I get to take a swing at him.
Yes, you do. You can use your reaction and take your swing.
Very curious what's going to happen with you.
That is a 24 to hit.
That definitely hits.
We're going to do 8 slashing for right now.
Okay. And again, strength saving throw, please.
Yep. And I think I get to do this one at advantage. Good thing too. It's an 18.
What weapon did you attack with?
My claws.
All right, that arm is now attached to this beast via its tendrils, and you won't have the use of that arm until you can free it.
Ooh, until no. I can free it?
Yeah.
Oh, my poor buddy.
I won't tell you what the DC is, but we've established that it's lower than 23 and higher than 18. So you've got a bracket there.
It's a hard bracket. I like it.
Someone complained that the combat in this campaign was too easy.
Oh, shush.
That same person was the first one to be attacked, too, so.
Speaking of which, Athel, you're up.
Okay. So how far away is the shadow thing from prone Athel at this point, would you say?
Almost right above you.
Okay, that works out. So I'm going to stand up, and I'm going to proceed to use Primal Savagery and slash at this thing with acidic magic claws.
Okay, so go ahead and make your attack roll.
That you said the bad word of magic.
That is 19.
19 does hit.
And then that is... Okay, so that is 16 damage.
Okay.
Acid-based, because of course.
All right, so yeah, the acid, the effect is actually odd, because where you hit on the surface, it doesn't seem to do anything, but as the acid sinks through the shadow, it's like it touches something deeper inside, and you can hear it sizzling, and the creature makes a weird keening, not quite like you would imagine a banshee's wail to be, not quite that loud, but it's not happy. And Athel, I feel like this is an excellent moment for you to make a strength saving throw.
Okay. Natural 20?
Natural 20, yep. You're able to yank your hand free. And Gromish, you're standing there with your arm stuck with your goblin friend who's a third of your size, apparently having been able to pull his arm free with no problem.
We're just doing the bodybuilder pose in the background.
I love the idea of Jane watching just Rhaegar having his hand stuck and Athel just pulling out the arm and fucking Gromish standing there just like, yeah!
Right. So, Rhaegar, this creature, just out of the shadow mass, a clawed hand is going to form. And I'm reasonably certain 25 does hit your AC.
I'm going to use a focus point, and I'm going to do weapon parry.
What does that
okay.
do?
Okay.
Let's see. On being hit, I can make a special weapon attack using my reaction to block damage. I make an attack roll, and I block the damage equal to the roll on my attack.
Okay. All right. Okay. So go ahead and do you have to succeed on an attack roll, or is this something where you just roll the damage? We're going to say it's something where you just roll the damage. If it's something different, we'll work it out later.
No, it says a natural 20 blocks the damage. So basically I'm rolling against the DC of the attack, I guess.
Oh, okay.
Something like that.
All right.
So, I don't know.
All right, so you're trying to beat 25.
And I don't have Reckless yet, so.
Nope.
That does not work.
Time to throw away the dice.
Well, I mean, it was a 17.
That's a good amount.
Certainly yeah. not.
Not quite, but good try. Those dice have escaped dice jail for just a moment.
Right. But it's all right. It's all right. I get a momentum dice out of that.
Oh, nice.
All right, so that's going to be 23 damage.
And that is...
magical. Necrotic.
All right, so yeah, so that doesn't get halved.
Nope.
Yep.
And
all
now, Rhaegar, I need you to make another strength save.
Come on, buddy. You can do it.
Natural 20.
Hey.
All right, that does succeed. So basically, this thing's claws dig into you, and you feel it using that grip to pull you toward it, but you're able to tear free from its horrific grasp. And that is actually going to bring us to your turn.
Wait.
One of your arms is still tangled up with this thing.
And that would be my whole action to get out of this, right?
So what I will allow is you could use your action to try to free yourself, and then if you wanted to make an attack with your offhand with your bonus action, I would allow it. Although, apparently, from what you've seen so far, anything that physically makes contact with this thing, it will try to grapple.
And I don't have any. I don't really have too many other options except for a once a day.
Yeah.
All right, I'm gonna. You know what? I'm gonna go a little bit stupid here.
Ooh.
For my bonus action, for my bonus action, the free hand, you're going to see me lifted into the air with the fingers outstretched, and I'm going to use another focus point to flourish and gain two more momentum dice, and I'm going to use my attack to hit him with a hemorrhaging wound. Let's see if he bleeds.
Ooh,
Okay.
okay.
And I'm doing this recklessly.
Right.
That is a 21 to hit.
21 definitely hits. Can you describe the hemorrhaging wound effect?
So the hemorrhaging wound effect, when I hit him with an attack, I can expend all the momentum die I've collected, which at this point is three, and I cause a bleeding wound, and they take damage at the end of their turn. One less dice per turn until zero dice. So over the next three turns, it's going to take D6s of damage as long as it bleeds.
Okay.
Nice.
And yeah. I guess I can roll. I can roll the first round now, I guess. Or I'll wait till the end of its turn.
Okay.
And I'll roll those dice. And I guess I have to make a strength saving throw.
If you want to try to free your arm, you do.
Yeah. If I get that option, I will take it.
Yep, so go ahead and make your strength save. Okay, so we've got a few things going on. Let's start with rolling the damage from that successful attack.
Oh yeah, that's right. I got so caught up in the other thing. Oh, right. And it also takes the momentum dice at the beginning anyways.
I was going to say, if you have a breath weapon or something that you're adding right now, we're just at rocks fall, everybody dies levels of, I'm done with complexity.
So basically what happens with the momentum dice is the first time I hit, it takes the damage of all the dice plus the damage, and then the
Right.
bleed effect happens later.
Gotcha.
And it is. Seven plus eight is 15 damage.
Yep.
Got a couple of ones there. Ugh. And so it takes 15 slashing plus six, so 21 slashing damage, sorry, on that attack.
All right.
And then over the next three turns, if it bleeds, it's going to be bleeding.
All right, so you need to make now for the arm that struck it, need you to make a strength save for that arm.
That's what I was thinking. That's what I thought was going to happen.
Yeah.
Okay. Don't make that strength save. I got double sixes.
All right, so at this point, both of your arms are stuck in this thing.
I
My
got him right
buddy.
where I want him, guys. He's grappled. I got both hands on him.
All right. I believe that will bring us to Jane.
Jane is going to use her action to cast aid. And she's going to give everyone 1d4. Oh, I'm reading it as I'm speaking.
You give each target hit points. Increase by 5 for a duration.
Yep. Just got to that part.
All right. Something I wanted to mention to you, Jane. At the level you are, when you take a shot with your bow, you get 2 shots. You have extra attack at the level you are. I believe you've only been taking 1 when you do that.
Yeah, Sin texted me that. Right after my turn.
Awesome. All right. So do you have any bonus actions or anything else you're going to do this turn?
I don't have anything else I can do, really.
Nope.
All right. Nope. So that moves it over to Gromish.
Who did you... did you aid everyone around you?
Everyone within range.
Cool. So I will add 5 temp and 5 max, I believe. Yes. Hit point maximum, current hit points, yes. So what Gromish is going to do is he's going to see the fact that Athol's acid kind of seemed to actually hurt it to like a slightly more significant degree. It actually had some kind of a cry of wound. And its ability, Elemental Cleaver, I can use a bonus action to change the infused weapon's current damage type to a different one among the damage types. So I'm going to change it from lightning over to acid. See if that helps any.
Right.
And then I will not take Reckless Attack or Great Weapon Master. Instead, I will just do 2 regular attacks with my Great Axe. See if it does anything. 27 to hit.
27 definitely hits.
Okay, and the second one will be a 18 to hit.
18 also hits.
Okay. Damage, hold on just a moment. 18. So that looks like it will be 55 acid damage. I'm trying to remember what my other damage was. About 55 acid damage.
All right. So yeah, definitely. It doesn't seem to do more to this thing than your other attacks did, but it definitely takes a clip out of it. Okay. And once again, we're going to need a strength saving throw from you.
Will do. Come on, dice, be nice to me. That'd be a dirty 20.
Dirty 20 does it. You're able to yank your axe free as the tendrils wrap around it.
Sweet. Just Gromish just slamming his. Do I do it twice because I had 2 attacks, or is it just once?
However you want the theatrics of it to look.
Okay. So he's just slamming his axe into it, pretty much just ripping through it. And through the same hole that he cut, he would probably slice through the same way, and then the tendrils probably grab onto it. Is why right. I kind of see in my head.
That's fair. Right, and that's going to bring us to Athol. All
right. So the beast is still up. Right, and can I try to gauge how it's doing?
It's hurt, but it's not showing any signs of wavering or backing off, and its grip on Renegar hasn't lessened any.
Okay, so seeing the amount of damage that Gromish has been doing fairly consistently to this thing, I'm going to cast Enlarge Reduce on Gromish and increase... his size to the next level. I don't know what that is at this point, but his dimensions double and his weight is multiplied by 8.
All right. So the big guy gets bigger.
It would be a huge creature.
Okay. All right, so the creature's eyes very much focus on Gromish as this is all happening, which is going to be pretty good news for you, Renegar, because seeing this growing threat, the creature is going to release its grip on you. And once again, it doesn't move in a conventional sense. It just disappears and reforms in a shadow behind Gromish.
It's pretty big shadow.
Yeah, so it's not like when it releases its grip, I can try and tighten my grip on it so it can't go anywhere.
I'll allow you to actually make a strength check to try to do that, but it's going to be an exceptionally high DC.
Hey, I'll take any chance I can get. I'm a gambling man. Let's see, that is. What's that? Athletics, right? That is a 25.
Doesn't do it.
Shit.
Wow.
I was on a 19.
God damn.
Right, so Gromish, this thing is going to appear behind you, and it's
Okay.
one size smaller than you. It's basically gouging at your kidneys.
Okay.
Does 17 hit your AC?
No, my one is 18.
All right, so it misses, and then it's going to take an action to try to. What it's essentially trying to do is wrap its tendrils around your legs and trip you. So that's going to be a dexterity save from you.
Not super good at those. Let's see how the dice fell. Nope, that's a five.
Okay, so.
That's a hell of a fall.
Athel, Jane, and
That's. Oh
Renegar,
no.
gonna need dexterity saving throws from all of you.
I am so scared right now for little
And
Jane.
I got a natural one.
Damn, son.
Jane got a 16.
Okay.
Asshole, no. Oh, it's gonna hurt.
Renegar, what'd you get?
I got a 15.
All right, so 15 just makes it. Jane, you were also able to get out of the way. Athel, I'm picturing this as you see Gromish start to fall, and you're like, "I'll catch you, buddy," and you take 6 points of bludgeoning damage.
Ouch.
A little overzealous after being able to get out of the goo when I couldn't.
Yeah, that's what I'm imagining.
Renegar, I believe your effect goes off at the end of this creature's turn, which it now is. So please roll whatever damage that is.
It takes 12 bleeding damage.
12 points of damage. Got it. And that's actually going to bring us back to Renegar's turn.
And so what I'm going to do is on my bonus action, the tattoo on my right shoulder now is going to glow, and I'm going to sort of like set up on all fours and open my mouth wide, and I'm going to shoot off, I'm going to fire off my Eldritch Blast,
Okay.
and I get to shoot two beams.
Hey.
Nice. So it'll be an attack roll for each.
That is a dirty 20 and a 21.
Both of those hit.
That is 2d10 worth of damage. That is 9 and 5. What's that?
14.
Yep, 14 damage.
All right, and that hits. The creature eats all of that. It's not something where you get the sense that the damage was reduced in any way.
All right. And I know it's not quote unquote smart to do this. but it's what I got. And I'm going to run in, and I'm going to take two swipes at it. I need to. You know what? Actually, the smarter thing to do is I'm going to run in. I'm going to take one swing at it. I know what it's going to do to me, and I don't want to be completely trapped. So I'm going to take one swing recklessly.
Okay.
I whiff badly. I rolled double sevens. I don't think a 14 hits.
No, but you do still have, I believe, have one more attack if you want to use it.
Yeah, sure. Why not? Better. I got a dirty 20.
That definitely hits.
Yeah, there we go. That is seven slashing,
okay. Once again, strength saving throw.
Yeah, I failed the saving throw. I rolled a 10 on the dice.
All right.
So unless 15 beats it, but I'm pretty sure it didn't.
No.
Yeah.
All right. So once again, your arm is tangled up with this thing. Jane, you are up.
Jane is going to try again with her shots. So we will roll that first attack. Yeah, Jane isn't hitting with that first attack at all. That was 12. A 12.
Yep, nope.
And not with that second one. That was 17.
17, you said?
Yes.
No, 17 does hit.
Okay, so that will be...
14.
Yeah, 14 damage.
Counting it because she has the baby in her arms.
All right. So the arrow hits, but it doesn't seem to... It hits and it does some damage, but it doesn't seem to dig in the way you would normally expect an arrow shot to do. Is there anything else you're going to be doing on your turn? Any other bonus actions or anything like that?
I'm going to bonus action healing spirit and kind of center it with the group, mostly on trying to include the three of them because I know I'm away from them at the moment.
Mm-hmm. All right, so that is doable. They're all in the same vicinity of each other. And it's definitely possible to affect both Gromish and Athel because one is pinned under the other at the moment.
Yeah, so they'll gain whoever's within the vicinity of the healing spirit will get 4 HP.
I don't think I've gotten injured yet, so that'd just be Rengar and Athel.
Yep.
I have a question real quick.
Hmm.
Aren't her arrows doing some psychic damage?
Oh yeah,
they are.
Only the first one.
Only the first one hits, so that'd be 4 psychic damage.
All right, we'll go ahead and
or 14. Mm-hmm.
Add that to it. Thank you for that note. All right,
it's already added in there, honey. I thought
that's what I was saying.
Plus 8. Yeah. Okay.
It's fine.
That's what I thought.
Yeah. All right, so that's going to bring us to Gromish's turn.
Okay.
You are on the forest floor with your friend pinned under you, with these creatures' tendrils sort of holding your legs together at the moment. If you wish to make an attack roll from this position, you'll do so at disadvantage, or you can make a strength check to try to break free of the of the grapple?
I think I'm going to try making a strength saving throw to get out of the grapple. And if I can, get off of my sweet little bud who tried catching me.
Yep.
So is that normal or disadvantage? I'm still raging, so.
You're raging, so that would, I believe, gives you advantage on strength-based ability checks.
That'll be a 13. I ain't doing it, Chief.
No. You're able to get off of the apple, though, so that's something.
Sorry, buddy.
Whew. You know, for the two strong boys in the party, we're not doing too good at being the strong boys in the party.
I pulled my axe out every time.
That actually reminds me, I unfortunately need to probably roll a concentration check at this point, as I needed to do that earlier, but I didn't want to interrupt.
Go ahead and do that.
And that's a 2. Do I have any more dice around here somewhere?
Okay. Still is DM dice. Sorry.
All right.
There we go.
So, Gromish, you've shrunk back down to your only large size because you're still raging. You get the size buff from that, but Apple's spell ended when you crushed him. I believe you still have your bonus action if you wish to use it. So, is there anything you want to do with that?
Sadly, I do not have anything to use that bonus action on, so I, will not. So that's the end of my turn.
Alright. Because I am a merciful DM, I'm going to say since you're shrinking and the creature has to adjust to your shrinking size, if you want to make a dexterity check to try to slip out as opposed to force your way out, I will allow that as a bonus action.
Okie dokie. That's a 21.
That does it. You're able to slip out, so you can use half your movement to get up, and you're done for this turn. All right.
I will also move an additional 20 feet away.
You're moving away from the creature?
Yeah. It seems to be focused on me, so I'm moving 20 feet away, see if I can either lure it away or have something else if it doesn't.
Well, since you're moving away without taking disengage, you're definitely keeping it focused because it's got an opportunity attack. Yeah.
Come get some.
Yeah, he rolled a natural 20, so he is in fact getting
some. Gravish really spiting their fear.
So that's going to be 23 damage. Necrotic.
All right, I'll take that.
Alright, so Athel, you are now lying in a U-shaped depression in the forest floor where your friend fell on you. What would you like to do?
So I'm gonna get up, and how far away is the monster at this point?
Almost right in front of you, about 10 feet away.
Okay, acid claws time. Two. That would be a 2. I'm going to grab another dice from you in a second there.
Okay, we're running out, so bring the ones that you've been giving up on back.
Okay. Yes, hand him the bad ones.
Clearly, I need these dice.
The rest of the party is watching and admiring Athel's bravery and literally nothing else about him at this time.
Absolutely beautiful.
Just overshoots it, jumps over the creature.
Athel, does 15 hit your AC? Actually, I know.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, by one.
All right, so it rolled really bad on the damage, so that's something. So you're only going to take 10 damage and be knocked prone.
Okay.
So basically, you run in to do your acid claw, and this thing just backhands you and knocks you back off your feet. Actually, right back into the U-shaped depression that was left. Okay.
It's like, stay in the hole. I made it for you.
And Jane, a tentacle is going to lash out at you. 25, I suspect, hits your AC.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it does.
All right. The tentacle actually isn't targeting you. It's targeting your bow. And so the good news is you're not taking any damage. You're not taking any damage. The bad news is your bow is now in multiple pieces.
No! Okay. Right. See, this is why I should play a monk. I could just throw my arrows.
Got multi-class now.
I believe at the end of the creature's turn, Renegar rolls some damage.
Oh, yeah. It takes 6.
Okay. So the creature takes that damage. And again, we're back to Renegar.
All right. So I'm going to use my last focus point here. And I'm going to reach my arm up again and flex the fingers out. I'm just going to come down. And I'm going to come down with another hemorrhaging wound after I have gained back my momentum dice for that. And I'm doing this recklessly. I'm keeping him bleeding. I want to keep consistent damage on a regular basis. Da, 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 21.
Definitely hits.
All right. So he's going to take 2d6 plus a d8. That is 6. So 11 plus 17 slashing damage. And the bleeding effect actually resets to the highest number of dice that it's had during this fight.
Okay.
And so it resets to 3.
Okay. And Jane, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe Renegar regains some health from starting his turn within the effect of your healing gun?
Yes, he does.
Mm-hmm. Do I roll a dice or?
Is it a D6, Jane?
I believe so. Yes. Right,
we're going to say it's a D6 and Renegar, you go
ahead and roll the die. Give me a second. It's 2.
2D6? Okay. And that is actually going to bring us to Jane's turn. Jane, who is standing holding the pieces of your beloved shortbow that's been with you for ages and ages.
So mad. I'm just losing things left, right, and sideways. Not just people this time. I guess who is the lowest of the group?
Almost certainly Rangar, I would imagine.
Yeah, I'm at 59.
At health or?
Health. Yes.
Yeah, that's going to be me at 10.
Oh. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so yeah. I'm going to. So, about that, we're going to move up to Athel, and I'm going to use Cure Wounds as an action, and then bonus action, Misty Step my way out of there.
All right. So
I don't think
roll
you
up.
Have any second level spell slots left, unfortunately.
Never mind. I won't Misty Step out of whatever about it. I don't know how far Athel is away from me, though.
Close enough. Close enough for you to get to them.
That will be 10 health.
Thank you.
So Athel, yeah, Jane runs up, heals you. And then she starts to Misty Step away, and the spell just kind of fizzles out. And she's like, yeah, I couldn't leave you hanging.
I'm with you till the end.
How you doing?
Oh my god, I wish I could do this.
How about that? You know that tree we had the other day? You want to hide in a tree? Just panic minor illusion.
Grommish, you are up.
All right. So I'm about 20 or so feet away from it. Am I 20 or 30 feet away from it?
You'd be 20 feet away at this point.
Okay, cool. So I will use the elemental cleavers throne property. Oh, actually, I'm 20 feet away from it. So I'll use this throne property. It's normal range of 20 feet or so. If I throw this weapon, it reappears in my hand the instant after it hits or misses a target. So I'm going to, at the throne range, throw it to see if I can hit it. So that's going to be my normal roll. I'm not doing it recklessly. Probably should have. That's a 12.
Yep. No joy.
And you know what? I'm going to Great Weapon Master this second throw just because I can. I want him hard. That was a bad plan. That's an 11.
Okay.
Dun-dun-ch, dun-dun-ch. That's me bombarding him with a massive weapon.
So Jane and Athel, you've got this gigantic axe flying over your head, and then it miss, and then it's luckily doesn't make contact. And you can fly a second time. Like, good times.
Jane's gonna turn to Grandma. She's like, "Buddy, be careful."
I get it back. Not be its turn.
Athel, you are up.
Okay. I'm going to try and swing at the monster again. Finally, 19.
19 does hit.
So that's going to be 19 damage.
Okay.
And that's acid. That's what the primal savagery, yeah.
Right. All right, so this time you don't need to make a strength saving throw. The creature does not try to grapple you. Instead, it stands up into a more humanoid form, and it's going to kind of look at the group in the condition you're in with your various injuries and your broken bow and so forth. And the creature, in a extremely cultured and elegant voice, an accent that's actually a little out of date, something you would expect a like very old elvish nobility to use, it's going to say, "Well, this has been delightfully fun. I've not been so entertained in a long time, but you've all reached the end of your amusement to me. Now, the borders between life and death are thin here, and for those who've made as many enemies on the other side as you all have, to come here was rather foolish. So two things are going to happen. One of them is that the creature is going to disappear and then reappear in a shadow about 40 feet away from the group in general, so it's not close to any of you. And then next to each of you, things are going to form out of the shadows. Renegar, for you, it's going to be... they're sort of shadowy apparitions of people who look like they had died in a fire. For Athel, it's going to be raiders who have claw marks across their chests. For Gromish, it's also going to be raiders who look like they were, who have like garish wounds from your weapons. And for Jane, it's going to be a couple of raiders who have arrows stuck in them. And it's going to be a couple of them on each of you.
Okay.
So, Renegar, one of these shadow creatures is going to swing at you and whiff on his attack. The other one is going to attack and it doesn't do a whole lot of damage. It just reaches out with its hand and touches you on the chest. And you get this feeling of icy cold running through you. You're going to take 3 points of necrotic damage. And you're going to have this momentary vision of the fire and what it did to that village and the panic ensuing from it.
Oh no!
Emotional damage.
So Athel, one of them is going to whiff on their attack. The other one is absolutely not going to do that. And you're going to take 10 damage.
Ow.
And you're going to have a vision of this person sailing across the sea, hoping to get revenge for the slights that the civilized folk had done to them over the years, and then them meeting an untimely end at your hand.
Yeah, go.
My claws, really.
Gromish, both of them are going to miss you. And then Jane, one of them is going to miss and one is going to hit. For three necrotic. And you're going to have a picture of this person, similar situation. They're on a ship. They were a good person who got recruited into this mercenary army, wanting only to make a better life for their family, and all those hopes ended with one of your arrows.
All right.
And Renegar, you're up.
I, even though I do see what happened, I knew what I was doing. I understood what the fire was going to do. And I'm going to break away from common at that point, and I'm going to look at the one that actually hit me and just in Noel start telling it, shouldn't have tried to feed us to that fucker. And I'm going to take a swing at him recklessly, which gets me a 25.
All right, so you slash through this thing, and the apparition fades away with 25 points of damage.
And I'll go after the other one.
Okay.
Uh, 19 to hit.
All right, 19 definitely hits. Oh, 19, yeah, definitely hits. Go ahead.
And so I will. Hey, that's 12 damage.
Okay, 12 damage. So again, your magically enhanced claws rake through this thing, doing damage, but not quite dispatching it. That brings us to Jane.
Jane is going to grab her necklace and also look at the trinkets in her bag for a moment and look at the apparitions and say, we were all protecting what we love. It's inevitable for the consequences to follow us. And you never know what you're doing, whether it's good or bad. People still hate you for it or love you for it. It's just how life is. I know you guys were trying to do something good in your brain. Trying to do something good for those you have at home or your life. And so was I. And I'm sorry for that. And she's going to attack them.
Okay.
That'll be a natural lovely one. She's too sad. She doesn't want to hurt them.
All right. So you drive your sword at this creature, and the creature just kind of sort of disapparates as you drive your blade into it. And then as soon as the blade is gone, it reforms and it goes, yeah, the speech was a lot more painful than your weapon.
Yeah, this is why I'm a ranger.
You do have another attack if you want it.
Sure, let's go. Non-range weapon, let's go. Got this. Yeah, no, that's another natural one right there. I'm not hitting anything.
So the other apparition is going to look at the first one and say, did we really get killed by her? Gromish.
transferred my luck to someone else.
Seems that way. Grubbish just don't look at the, I assume, two that are in front of him. And he just kind of like looks and he just goes, "Surrender!"
There's no response from them. They're just staring at you with weapons, with their sort of ghostly weaponry at the ready.
All right. Yeah, he's going to like look at them. He's going to walk past them. He's not even going to try to hit them. He's going to walk past proc both attack of opportunities on purpose. Pretty much being like, I'm telling you to surrender. Do what you want, as he's doing, pretty much walk past them. He's like, surrender, and they don't answer, so he's just walking past them.
All right, so one of them misses, the other one's going to hit you for 9 necrotic damage.
Ouchies. Okay. Let me put that in here real quick. So it's going to hit him, and he's gonna look at him again, kind of raise, like, grab his axe and say, "Surrender, or you will die again."
Right. Again, nothing. You get no reaction.
All right. In that case, with slight hesitance, he is going to do a single attack for to be a 13 to hit.
All right. So that does hit.
Okay. And that's 21 damage.
All right. So you cleave right through this thing and it just vanishes.
Mm-hmm.
The one standing next to it shows no signs of being concerned about this. Its attention is still on you, and it's still entirely hostile.
Yeah. The other one hasn't said anything. Shagram just don't look back at him, considering it still hasn't said anything. And I'm assuming it kind of missed the swipe. It's going to leave it alive and do a throwing attack towards the one who comment on Jane. Because I think they attacked her, if I remember correctly.
All right.
So he's going to throw out the one that attacked Jane.
Okay.
So that's going to be a 20 to hit, 16 damage.
16 damage. All right. So the thing is still up, but it did take damage.
Okay.
And that's going to bring us to Apple.
Okay, so the big shadow thing is still within fairly close by, right? Like, it's still visual.
You can still see it, but it is somewhat obscured by the trees.
Okay, that doesn't matter for me, as I'm going to cast Call Lightning centered on its location. So it has to make a dexterity saving throw of 13.
It succeeds.
Okay, so it takes half damage. So half of 18 is 9. So it takes 9 lightning damage.
And it's going to, when it takes its damage, it's going to say, "Not very sporting." And it's just going to fade from your view. And it's an effect where the shadow that it was standing in is still there. Nothing has changed. You just can't see it there anymore.
Spooky.
Okay.
Are you doing anything else on your turn?
Yeah, I'm going to back away from the... Oh, crap, I can't disengage. Never mind, I'm not going to back away from it, because they could probably take me down right now, so... I'm done.
Alright, so it's the enemy's turn. Athel, the ones that are engaged with you, one of them is going to grab you and throw you on the ground, and the other one is going to drive a spear at you. But as it does... another form appears above you and deflects the weapon with a weapon of their own. This is a goblin woman, a spectral form of a goblin woman. And the one that had thrown you down, you're going to see it kind of look away from you and its eyes kind of roll back, and then it just disappears. And a goblin man is going to be standing over you and he's going to grab you by your garment and pull you to your feet. And you, this person is very familiar to you. And it's going to take you a minute to recognize where you've seen this face before. And you realize that where you've seen it before was in the mirror. And Jane, between you and the people you've been fighting, they're going to form two gnomes. One of them is a young woman, and one of them is a man who, however red your hair is, his is redder. And he's going to, like with a gnome-sized rapier, he's going to poke one of the apparitions and then step around and do a twirl and then poke the other one. And the woman is going to look at you and smile. And again, her features are very familiar to you. And she's going to say, I know he can be a bit much, but to a young gnome lass, it was too much charm to ignore. And she's going to say to you, we will deal with these shadow creatures as best we can. We need you to take out the big one. And throughout the forest, around all of you, there are more sort of spectral gnomes and goblins forming and beginning to take on these shadow creatures. And one of them is going to, in the direction that the shadow creature was, say, the border between life and death is thin here, and it's very foolish for one of as many enemies as you to be messing around here. And then he's going to turn and look back at the party. And you can all see where this creature is again. Whatever effect it was using to obscure itself is gone. Which brings us back to Renegar's turn.
Fancy.
Well, if he's within reach, I'm going to rush him and I'm going to attack him.
All right. So yeah, you can get to him and you can attack him.
I'm going to use my action and my bonus action, and it's going to be three swings recklessly.
Okay.
And that is a 17.
17 hits.
A 23.
23 hits.
And a 21.
All three hit.
Woo! Let's see, that is going to be 3D.
Pulling out a special dat for this.
All right, so that is, let's see, 14, 7, and 8 slashing damage.
Okay, so that's okay. Go ahead and make a strength saving throw.
Here we go. Ooh, good thing for the advantage, but I don't think it helps me. I don't think it actually helps me. Uh, 16.
All right, so again, a tendril wraps around your arm and restrains you. So that's going to bring us to Jane, and Jane, just everybody can get to this thing if that's what you want to do.
Not that there's really much for me to really do.
I mean, stabbing could work.
I have stabbing. That's about it.
Athel's also very weak at the moment.
Yeah, I was going to ask, what's Athel's health looking like?
11.
Sweet child. Child.
Much damage.
Why haven't you taken a potion?
Because I've been busy trying to deal with the big guy.
Okay, so I'm going to cure wounds the child. Again.
Killing the bad guy is still keeping the party alive, okay?
Yeah, you know, it's fine. Don't worry about it. That's going to be an 11. Oh my gosh. Okay.
Just doubling health every time.
He keeps losing that exact health every time. I'm not leaving Athel's side. You know what? There's so much I can do. I have one more chance to heal you, you freaking goblin.
Okay.
Alright.
Just saw Mom and Dad. We don't need you joining them.
Alright.
Actually, even better, real quick.
Mm-hmm.
I just lost one person that's close to me. I really don't need another one going to. Okay? It's not even been 3 days yet. I'm over it. Don't. Okay? Next time I have to heal you, I'm going to slap you.
Noted.
Yeah. So one of the apparitions nearby that could only be one of Athel's brothers who perished in the attack is going to look at Jane and say, look, I love my people, but getting attached to goblins isn't generally a winning proposition.
Just a friend that might die soon.
Gromish, that's going to bring us to your turn.
Okey-dokey. Do I have a lower initiative than the higher initiative than Athel?
Yes.
Oh, okay. So I'm going to move until I'm about 20 feet away from the big guy. Seeing that Rangart just went fucking head first into it. Gonna go about 20 feet away. Do reckless attack for both my attacks, as well as great weapon master, applying a minus 5 to both of them. And toss both my weapon twice. First time is going to be a natural 20. So that's gonna be painful for him. And then my second one is going to be a 21 to hit.
Both hit.
Okay, so that's going to be... hold on just a moment. Do-do-do, critical dice. Okay. That's going to be... that again, cool. Be 20... 3 plus 5 plus 27 and then 1d8. That will be plus 2. 46 damage.
All right, that hits. The creature eats all of that. It's still up, but it looks like it's the shadow form is starting to almost breathe in an exaggerated way, as if it's having trouble holding itself together. And that's going to bring us to Athel. All
right, so I do need to roll a concentration check because I had a spell going. I just didn't want to interrupt things. And that's actually a 16, so I think I'm fine there. And speaking of that spell, I am going to retarget Call Lightning on the big thing again.
Okay.
So it has to make another dexterity saving throw of 13.
What was the save?
13. It has to beat 13.
All right. So it fails. The lightning strikes. Renegar. You're not going to take any damage from this, but it's not lost on you that your ally just set off a lightning bolt directly in front of you to something that was touching you. You definitely get some tingle off of this. So the lightning bolt hits. The shadow form completely evaporates. You are no longer being grappled, Renegar. Standing where the shadow creature was is an angelic being about 8 feet tall, in beautiful armor with luminescent white wings. And this creature is somewhat androgynous, but so beautiful that it is hard to look at. And it's going to look out over all of you, and as it appears, the shadow creatures that it had summoned to fight you disappear. And in that same exaggerated, elegant tone, this creature is going to say, "You fought well, and you regained your forest, and it means absolutely nothing. The Firebringer stirs." And it's going to bound up into the air and flap its wings and fly off at a speed where it's just gone. Like, you can't react or anything. Like, by the time you realize it's happening, this thing's gone. You're out of combat.
Grom is just gonna kind of look around, kind of look back at Jane and go, not dragon anymore. Dragon stir?
I don't know.
Oh.
Ethel is going to proceed to stand up, or might have already been standing, I don't remember not being prone, but he's going to stand up, he's going to walk over to the nearest tree, and slump against it, as even with all of Jane's healing, he's still like a solid 15 health short.
Can Jane go over and hit him? Or just, no, an aggressive pat on the head. Heal him again. I'm gonna cure wounds this freaking goblin child.
All right, yeah. So you do a cure wounds backhand across the face.
Yeah.
You need to make that how.
This is for nearly dying. Here's some 6 health.
Thank you.
Grab is just a look James at Rhaegar and be like, "It fly, I save." Good job. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
I'm just, you can see me just visibly outraged at this. I'm just staring at my hands and looking up at the sky at the same time, just speechless with how angry I'm just.
No, he's gonna kind of walk over to you. I mean, he's at half health at the moment, so he's probably like giant cuts across his body and blood flowing freely. He doesn't really seem to notice too much, but he walks over to you and gently puts his hand on your shoulder. More or less as like a I'm kind of here statement of like a hey, how you doing kind of thing. He's just gonna go breathe for a buddy. In, out. Is that helpful, my mama? That is probably helpful.
Yes. It's you smell the flowers, blow out the bees.
Nah.
And if they're not breathing, you hit them.
He's not like look at Rhaegar.
She's gonna yell. She's like,
so like look
at
Rhaegar.
She's gonna
like,
yell that and then glare at Athel.
You.
She's unamused. She's still really mad about her bow.
You breathing for a buddy? Do I need to hit you? You good? Breath?
Got away.
Oh, they do that. It's like when you try to grab a squirrel and it runs away, you know? So you can always get another squirrel. Yeah. Squirrels are good. They make good stew.
So, Jane, the red-headed gnome, is going to walk over to you and give this courtly bow, while the woman gnome who was with him is going to... She's got this expression where it's between... She's sort of rolling her eyes, but she also clearly finds this charming. And he's going to say, "Sadly, I cannot stay, but I can give you a parting gift." And with a flourish, he's going to hand his rapier to you, handle first.
Ooh. Oh, thank you.
And that weapon is +2 to attack and damage.
Oh, my.
And with that, your mom is going to rest her hand on your dad's shoulder, and she is going to say, "It's so good to see you. please take care of your grandfather. He's had a hard however many decades this has been. And with that, they're both going to fade away. And Athel, your parents and your brother, who had the one, not the one who was still alive, but the one who had passed away in the attack, are they're going to be just absolutely beaming at you. Like, you did so good. You just kept running in no matter how many times you got hit, no matter how many times you missed. You were always there for it. You are the goblinest goblin we've ever seen. We couldn't be more proud of you. And it's like they're all talking over each other and they're absolutely hyped about this. And it's the kind of thing where they don't even seem to notice as they begin to fade away. Now, what's going to happen is that at a point some distance from you, the light, the forest is going to go to a normal level of illumination. It's getting to be late afternoon at this point, but it's still pretty bright out. And you can see toward the center of where the patch of gloom was, there's a large tree that was completely dormant. You're going to hear a cracking and splintering sound. And when you all look that way, what you're going to see is it's this tree sprouting new branches and leaves. Aww. And the trees around it are going to begin to do the same thing. So in a matter of a few minutes, it's going to go from being this completely lifeless forest to being the greenest and most vibrant place any of you have seen in years.
Robin's just going to pat Rengar on the back and just be like, the wing guy flew away, but is just to like point at the ground, flower! A tree. Big, healthy. Yeah. Be happy for a buddy. Big, healthy. Big, yeah. Healthy forest. You helped. You did. Just like thumbs up towards them.
I'm not really looking at him, just kind of like looking off to the side, a little distracted and still enraged, just
Just the yeah, sure, child. He's Robins just don't keep talking like that.
Alright. So as you all are sort of settling in, tending to your wounds, you know, cleaning off your weapons, whatever it is you would be doing in this situation, you're going to hear approaching footsteps, and it's the gnomes and goblins who had escorted you here. I think Jane is going to be the first one to notice this about the group, and in particular about her grandfather, where he was moving slowly and really struggling. He is now walking with a spring in his step. He looks 20 years younger. And what else you're going to notice is the same way you walk around with sort of your fey-touched magical aura about you, he now has that about him. There's almost a glow about him. And to a lesser extent, that's true of almost everybody in your party. Athel, you're going to notice your brother is still kind of a dour disposition, but he's more of a dour disposition like you would associate with a high elf as opposed to the dour disposition of a non-magical person. So he still has gained a magical aura that he didn't have.
That's something, at least.
And Jane's grandfather is loudly going to proclaim, like, you did it. You restored the forest. We're going to plant more of these magical trees so our power isn't centered on one. And he's going to clap his hands together, and just a fairly slight drizzle is going to start to fall where the sky was clear just a few moments ago. It's not much, but it's the most rain any of you have seen in years. And as it falls, he's going to look a bit disappointed, and he's just going to go, huh, this should be a downpour. Something's still interfering, but it's something.
Rama's just going to walk over to Jane and kind of put his hand under her and lift her onto his shoulder. And he just goes, it's good rain. Bigger rain,
Jane is going
bigger
to...
monster.
Jane is going to look up at the sky and just soak up the rain and smile. It's like, yeah, bigger monsters will come, but It's okay. At least we were able to save people.
All right. What's Renegar? Renegar at this point has had a few minutes to collect himself if he wants to. What's he going to be doing? Or is he still just staring off into the distance in the sky going, dirty bitch, come back and fight me?
No, at this point, when the rain has started and it's kind of washing over him, it like almost feels like for the first time he's felt that. And just sort of just like eyes closed, just face upturned into the rain while it's just washing over him.
Okay. And Athel, what are you going to be doing?
Athel is slow to get up. The wounds of the battle still pretty deeply affecting him, but it's also like he's not nearly as talkative or cheerful as the others. The appearance of his brothers and also how close he came to death seeming to affect him quite deeply as he sort of stares off into the distance.
All right. So you all are pretty much swarmed by these gnomes and goblins, and they're basically feeding you healing potions as you need them, so your injuries are going to be recovered pretty quickly. And Athel, your remaining brother is going to walk up alongside you and going to say, you did well.
Thank you. It was very taxing. I understand why you're so dour if you had to fight something like that on the regular.
Yeah, well, equipped to fight it now if it comes back. And he's going to look up at this sort of light drizzle and he's going to say, that spell should make it be pouring down rain right now. We should have to be looking for cover from the rain, which means that something's still interfering.
Sorry, have you heard about a dragon? Something about a dragon wakes, actually. Because the thing that flew away mentioned that we regained the forest, but it didn't matter because the Firebringer stirred. We've been hearing about a dragon stirring, so.
Well, yeah, I've heard the saying, the dragon stirs. It's something about a restoration of an old order. I don't exactly know what it means. And he's going to kind of stare off into the distance, kind of squinting. And he's going to say, I've heard older elves speaking in common, and they'll sometimes use words differently. Like, they'll sometimes say, the candle is giving off fire, or they'll sometimes say, words mean differently in old common, and maybe whatever you fought was very old and spoke a different version of the language.
It flew. Makes sense. Very fast. Very tall. It's weird.
So the first time that any of you have seen Athel's brother, Grek, is going to genuinely smile with the rest of the group and say, I know it was a really hard fight. Thank you so much for keeping my brother safe.
Grommish is going to look at him, give him a kind of big, toothy smile of sorts, and he just goes, we good. We try to do good, and we continue to be good. Thank you for letting us be good.
Grek is
Jane's
going
to...
Go ahead. Go ahead, Jane.
Jane is going to add in, it's like, you know, just by almost nearly dying, he's a pretty cool goblin. I'm glad he's part of our group. Though, he can't handle a drink worth anything. But
I can handle a drink better than you. I'll have you to...
You know what? Well, you can test that later, little buddy.
Both so same size.
Grek is going to say, that sounds like an excellent plan. He's going to clap his hands together and say a few words in Celestial. I don't think any of you speak it, but you would probably recognize the language. Mm-hmm. And a table is going to appear set with food and drink for all of you. And he's going to just kind of wave his hand toward the table and say, I would say you all will get first pick of this.
Robin's just gonna call over to Rhaegar and be like, Fur buddy! Ale!
I snap back to attention, all excited, and I just come bounding over.
Jade is going just as fast. She needs a drink.
Athel still seems a little melancholic. He definitely reanimates by quite a bit as he heads over.
And bread.
Yes, bread.
Grammar's gonna look at Athel's brother and go, bigger sky blocker. If you need help, we can give help.
So Athel's brother Grek is going to think about that for a second, and he's gonna kind of nod and he's gonna say, "Well, I know you have a quest to complete. You're supposed to go observe the battle. After you've done that, if you could track down what exactly the dragon stirs means, that might be really helpful to us, because apparently it has something to do with whatever destroyed our village, and whatever it is, it's still out there."
He's gonna kind of like tap his chest, and he's just gonna be like, "Little mama will remember that. Little mama, after battle, track down words." She remembers things so well.
Ale time. I'm drinking! No!
Yes.
At least I'm sober at this moment. Buddy.
Use paper buddy. Skill.
And I guess Jane's going to write it down.
In this moment, Greg's smile is going to become a lot more forced, and he's going to go, "I'll remind you in the morning."
Sounds good.
So the gnomes and goblins set up camp and they set up tents for you in this, and I can't emphasize this enough, just blooming, verdant forest. And just in the time that you guys are there eating and drinking, you start to see things like birds and insects starting to make their way back among the plant life in the woods. So the next time we meet, this seems like a pretty good place to leave things for the evening. The next time we meet, you all will have had the benefits of a long rest, and you all will be level 6.
Sweet.
Ooh.
Right. Did you mean level 7?
I should say, I'm sure among the party of goblins and gnomes who are escorting you, someone is able to scare up another short bro to replace the one that was broken in the fight.
That would be nice. Also, isn't it level 7 we're going to be? Or?
Whatever is one more than you are now, that's the one you will be.
Okay.
If someone could actually send that in the chat when we figure it out, because for some reason I don't have it clearly marked on my sheet either, so.
All right, you know what? We're going to say level 7. If it means 2 levels for anybody, that's fine. We'll just do level 7.
Cool.
And with that, we're kicking it back over to Tim to see us out.
All right. Well, hopefully you guys all enjoyed this episode. If you guys did, always feel free to catch us at 4:30 p.m. PST on Wednesdays. Wherever it is that time is in your time zone, feel free to check it out. And feel free to go and check out several of our socials, which will be inside the link tree that I'll be posting inside the chat. In there is our website. It has our up-to-date weekly schedule and what times we do them and what games we do them. So if you guys want to check that stuff out, you'll be able to see all of our stuff a lot easier and be able to access it a lot easier, I suppose. And we'll see all of you fine folks tomorrow at 7 p.m. PST for some Borderlands 1. We're going to continue doing the DLC, which will be some zombie fighting. So hopefully we'll see you guys there. And have a good night, ladies and gentlemen. And thank you, Benny, or I believe Autist DM, I believe is your tag on TikTok.
It is.
All right. And go check them out if you guys want DM tips. All right. Have a good night, ladies and gentlemen. Bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye.